Thanks, Bob, and thank you all for coming. I hope we can keep you entertained and informed of some of the controversies. And tonight I'm going to speak as a scientist and also as a medical doctor, a real doctor. Because sometimes my children ask me, can you get me a real doctor? So I happen to work in genetics, and it's one of those areas that's actually quite controversial. Controversial in the sense that we know that genetics is not deterministic, and yet anytime you hear geneticists talk about the importance of their work, it's like, I clone the gene, and this gene does X, Y, Z, and as a result of that, if you have an alteration in this particular gene, you may get cancer. And so when I started my career here, I really wanted to understand genetics a little bit deeper, because my mentor, Jani Rowley, had spent all her career arguing with her colleagues about the importance of genetics in cancer etiology. Because at that time, everyone thought chromosome alterations in cancer were epiphenomenal, right? Everyone was convinced that it was what we ate, it was the environment, and so it had nothing to do with genetics. And yet, if you go back in the literature, the area I'm particularly interested in is in breast cancer. And Broca, a really famous French scientist, just observed, you know, generations of women in families who developed breast cancer. And in 1866, actually wrote about it. And of course, it took generations. In fact, it took 25 years of work finding families like that to finally identify the locus on chromosome 17 that was going to harbor the BRCA1 gene. And I remember attending a conference with Mary Claire King and Francis Collins at the time when everyone was really out to map disease genes. And the idea was that we would find these genes and they're going to explain diseases. And guess what? We're mapping these genes one gene at a time. What if we all go to Congress and ask for $5 billion and just do the Human Genome Project? Right? It was a Gordon conference, and I remember the conversation and the excitement in the room when these big discoveries were sort of leading us to go tell the public that they should give us $5 billion so we can find the human genome. And the idea was that why find genes one at a time? Why don't we just find all of them? All of us have maybe five or more genes that are sort of altered. And if we can just identify the genetic mutations, then we can get to precision medicine. You're hearing about precision medicine now. Right. But the one thing that was really exciting about the Genome Project was that we at that time realized that, in fact, genetics had been used for bad purposes in the past, because history is always very important. Eugenics, you know, there were physicians who actually believed that you needed to get rid of people who were not fit. And so as part of asking for money from Congress, we actually had 5% of the Human Genome Project committed to studying the ethical, social, and legal implications of the research we were going to do. And I remember the interdisciplinary group that would come together to think about, you know, we as doctors thought, let's just go find everybody who has a genetic mutation. Why not? We can just wipe that out. And then we would be in a meeting with rabbis and social scientists who would say, what makes you think that that's what people want to do, right? That was really humbling, because it was early on in my career where I thought if we just found this gene, we could actually prevent people from getting cancer. And it turned out it was the wrong answer, because in fact, there are many reasons why people want to live with whatever disability that they have. And for us to expect that we're going to get to a perfect state of health was actually maybe not attainable. And at that time, we thought we had all the genes and we could get it in the one big genome project. And it turned out as we did more studies, we realized that we don't have just one genome, that each of us has our own personal genome. While it cost us $5 billion to find, to put together the first map of the genome, the more we've studied, the more we've sort of gone into looking at how genes work, the more we realize that there's so much dark matter in our genome that we don't understand. So now, 20 years after we've identified BRCA1 and we've actually been doing genetic testing, I then go to my clinic and I have to explain the fact that we promised you all that when we got $5 billion to clone the human genome. But guess what? We don't know nearly enough. Because even though we thought we could have genetic testing and we could predict who was going to have cancer and who was not going to have cancer, with 20 years of work, we know that it's probabilistic, it's not definite, right? And that's really where I think we can, as scientists, really learn to be able to help patients if we can, and then to realize our limitations when we don't know nearly enough to be able to use the information that's so powerful. So having said the limitation of genetic testing, let me then tell you some of the challenges that we have when we don't communicate risk appropriately. So on one of those panels where we had sure reason to believe that in this family, women have an increased risk for breast cancer, and they might get ovarian cancer if they didn't go for genetic testing. And this woman told me, oh, no, it's all about the environment. And I said, no, this your family is for sure, based on probability, you have a very high probability to have a genetic mutation. Anyway, to cut a long story short, there are many families who are afraid to come forward because we are worried about stigma, we're worried about insurance discrimination, we're worried about all the other social aspects that us as scientists don't think about. So I know my colleague is going to talk about the social aspects of it, but I think it's an example of where we can promise too much, and unless we deliver the rest of it to the public, they're not going to be willing to accept the fact that these discoveries can actually improve human health, can get us to better health. And that's why I think that scientists need to do a better job of not only doing the discovery, but actually talking to people that the results of their research actually would impact. If I was not a physician who really goes to clinic and talks to families, I may not have really understood the fact that there are individuals who don't want to know, and it's their right not to know. And then there are others who actually want to know. And even if you tell them that they don't need to know, they want to know. And that's really the beauty of human beings, right? So unpredictable. Now, let me use my second example, which is really this whole idea about vaccine. So how many of you know the one thing that was actually good that the former governor of Texas was going to do? Yes. Vaccine, right. Yeah. So what happened was that the governor of Texas, when he heard about HPV vaccine, which is one vaccine that can eradicate most of cervical cancer, and cervical cancer kills too many people globally, and he was going to get every student in Texas vaccinated. And it's like, what? You're going to vaccinate them against HPV and then give them permission to have sex? That was the end of it. And US now is one of the countries with the lowest rates of HPV vaccine. even though we have scientific evidence that when you vaccinate young girls, you can basically eliminate cervical cancer. And guess what's one of the highest, fastest growing cancers in this country? Head and neck cancer, oral cancers, all related to HPV. So there's a concept of herd immunity. You have to get a certain proportion of the population vaccinated to get that herd immunity. And we're not getting it in this country because the religious belief about vaccine is preventing a lot of families from adopting widespread HPV vaccination in this country. So our vaccination rate is about 37%, whereas in other countries, Australia is up to maybe 90% because they just accepted the fact that they can basically eliminate cervical cancer by vaccinating children. So sometimes this the public has an opinion, and in the area of genetics and in the area of vaccination, these are really important areas of research where we've really made a lot of advances, and we need to do a better job of communicating the importance of the work we do to the public. Vaccines, you know, eradicating polio, eradicating measles, all of these things used to be deadly for young children. And now we have the most educated, the most sophisticated in this country actually doubting that vaccines do anything to children. If anything, they don't want their children vaccinated because there's a risk that the child may have autism. I mean, so many reasons why people are doubting vaccination. And I think we probably, as physicians, we've lost some opportunity to educate the general public. Because in the early part of this century, children were developing polio and getting paralyzed. Children were dying of measles, chickenpox, and lifespan was less than 60. But now that people are living longer, we've really forgotten what it used to be like. Thank you.